All right, so we are recording this for you later, Dr. LaVigna.
Okay.
All right. Guys, I have the honor of introducing Dr. LaVigna to you. He's a co-founder of the Institute for Applied Behavior Analysis. He's an internationally recognized authority on establishing effective, non-aversive behavioral support services for people who are responding to their life conditions with severe and challenging behavior. His work is reported in numerous peer-reviewed articles and books, and it's an honor to have him today. He's gonna go over his how many year career, Dr. LaVigna?
Well, it's been 50 years since I came out to Camarillo State Hospital.
50 years. So he's going to talk about his career at Camarillo State Hospital and his life as a very respected and well-renowned entrepreneur in town. So it's our honor to have him as our guest. Thank you, Dr. LaVigna, for being here.
My pleasure. Okay. Nice to see everybody. Like I said, I've been here for 50 years. Let's see. The thing doesn't seem to be working here. Can't seem to.
Your slide's not working?
It's not, yeah, it's not. Let me see. There we go. Did you do something or did I do something?
That was you. I already had all my tech breakdowns today.
Okay, there we go. Now it seems to be working. Okay. My wife and I were born in New York and raised there and married there. But I did my graduate work in Chicago at the University of Chicago. And we were there for 5 years. I was finishing up my coursework. And the winters were horrible. I mean, just absolutely horrible. So my wife said, Gary, please find a job where it doesn't snow. So I flew out to a psychology conference in San Francisco. And attending there was the lead psychologist at Camarillo State Hospital. They were looking for somebody to help them to develop a program for autistic adolescents and adults. Today, they'd say adolescents and adults on the spectrum, but that's the way they talked back then. And I didn't know anything about autism, really. I had never met a person with autism before, never had a course about autism before, but I did have an emphasis in my graduate program on applied behavior analysis. I don't know if you've met behavior analysts yet, but we have required courses in arrogance. Arrogance 1, 2, and 3, it's a whole sequence of courses. And I excelled in those courses. And I said, well, yeah, I can do that job. I mean, here's what I thought I knew about autism. These were people who had not learned to do the right thing and instead had learned to do the wrong thing. And if you wanted to cure autism, all you needed to do was to teach them how to do the right thing and to not do the wrong thing. And as a behavior analyst, I knew how to teach. So I said, yeah, I could take that job. So I took the job. I was offered the job, took the job, never having been to a state hospital before, never having met a person with autism before. Told Brenda, my wife, we got the job. We put the kids in our Volkswagen van, drove out to California, moved into the house that we're still living in here today, 50 years ago. It's been 50 years. Drove out to the state hospital for the first time. Went to the unit that I was assigned to. Adolescents and adults. They wanted me to develop a program for the people there. And I knew I was in trouble when I heard the door behind me close and lock. Here's what I saw. While there were 50 people, males and females, living on this unit, in this big day hall, there were only maybe 35 chairs. So there weren't enough chairs for everybody to have seats to sit in. So some of them were just laying on the floor. They introduced me to the first person they wanted me to work with. He's a tall man, 6'2", 22 years old. He would push his arms together like that, do other exercises. He's nonverbal, but he had the perfect body. He was strong, he was tall. He was certainly bigger than me. And they said, when he misbehaves, you need to take him down the hallway to the timeout room and put him in there. And I looked up at this man, bigger than me and stronger than me. And my first interest in positive behavior strategies had nothing to do with science or experience, had to do with cowardice. I was not gonna make somebody bigger and stronger than me do something they didn't wanna do. And that literally was my cowardice was my first inclination towards positive strategies. And I was embraced by some of the staff there who took good care of me. And one teacher in particular, her name was Jody King at the time. She's now Jody Gall. She introduced me to the clients there and more individually. And something occurred to me as I'm hearing about this problem. I'm thinking, well, they haven't had an opportunity to develop, to learn. And one of the experiences I had, even at that point in my life, I was not 30 years old yet. I was still 29. We moved into California with five kids before we were 30 years old. And the experience I had was we had made a decision ourselves, Brendan and I, my wife and I, that our children would go to Montessori school. And Montessori had materials and methods aimed at early development. And since a lot of the people we were working with were functioning below the five-year-old level, psychologically and cognitively, I said, why don't we set up a Montessori environment for them? So we did that. And remarkably, they improved developmentally dramatically based on the Denver Developmental Screening Test. So that was kind of interesting. And I started to read more about Montessori and recognized that she had studied with a French physician educated by the name of Seguin. And he had studied in turn with a French psychiatrist by the name of Itard. And Itard had written a book called The Wild Boy of Aberon. They had found a adolescent boy wandering the forest of Aberon in France, thinking he was nonverbal, and they thought he had been abandoned as an infant and raised by wolves. That's why they called him the Wild Boy of Aberon. Then they ended up giving him the name Victor. But Victor never did learn to speak, never learned to speak, but Itard, in fact, taught him how to read and write. He was able to communicate using the written word. And he described in his book, and the book is available, The Wild Boy of Aberon. In this book, he described the different steps he went through to teach this boy, this nonverbal boy, adolescent boy, how to read and write. Starting with shape discrimination, color discrimination, letter discrimination, word discrimination, and so on. And so I kind of took out that information, organized it into what I called the Tardian Reading Program, superimpose the discrete trial teaching method, which is a behavioral teaching method, on it. And my first publication was where I had worked with three nonverbal young adults, taught them to communicate expressively and receptively using three written word cards. The word cards were drop, corn, and mint, which stood for candy corn, and the four-letter words. If you, I didn't want them to discriminate the length of the word. I wanted to discriminate the letters. And it took very little time using discrete trial methods. I didn't have to go through all the Etardian steps. In a thousand trials or so, about, they learned to use all three word cards expressively and receptively. If I said, "What's this?" they held up the right word card. If I said, "Take this," they took the right piece of candy. How did I know they were understanding what the word card stood for? If they gave them a choice of candies, they would pick the gumdrop, regardless of what it was paired with. They would pick the corn if it was paired with the gumdrop, excuse me, with the mint, but not if it was paired with the candy corn. And they would pick the mint only if it was the only choice available to them. In other words, they had favorite candies. And then they gave them their choice of word cards. And their choices of the word cards were the same as their choice for candies. So they knew what the word card stood for. Like I said, that was my first publication. The other thing that I pursued over those years was to come up with strategies that precluded the need to use any punishment or aversive procedures in working with them. I'm only being partly funny when I say I was a coward. The reason you don't want to use aversive or punitive procedures with people, one of the reasons, aside from ethics, is that it creates a condition which makes aggression itself more likely to occur. And we made tremendous progress in that, but it didn't matter what we taught, it didn't matter what behavior problems we solved. The only thing that allowed people in the state hospital to move back into the community, back home and back into the community, was if there was somebody out there, family or program, willing to take them. It didn't matter what skills we taught, didn't matter what problem behaviors we solved. The only thing that determined whether they were able to move into the community is if there was an agency available to and willing to work with them. So I decided to jump the fence. In 77, 78, I left the state hospital and directed an agency that was a parent-run agency, but they hired me to be the clinical director, and we created some of the first living arrangements, group homes, and day services for adults with the on the spectrum, as well as other services. And during this time, I was sharing what I had learned with others, lecturing, like I'm lecturing today with you guys, and met a colleague, Tom Willis, who came to one of my lectures. He introduced himself. He had a tremendous reputation. He came out to visit me at where I was working one day and said he was looking for a job. He was practicing as a sole practitioner, and He was tired of working in such an isolated way, and he was wondering if I'd be willing to hire him to work for our agency. I said, that's a good idea. I said, let me think about that. Well, that night I went to a board meeting, I was fired. They fired me from my job. Now, it had to do with some misunderstanding, but I was fired. So I called Tom Willis that night. I said, you know that idea of us working together? I think that's a great idea. And so we decided to form the Institute for Applied Behavior Analysis. The Institute for Applied Behavior Analysis exists because I was fired from my job and I needed to create something. The one thing that Tom and I agreed to is that, and this was this has led to the growth of our agency, is that we would only use aversive restrictive procedures if we had no other option, that we would use strictly positive procedures to the extent that we could. And over the years, right now we're employing about 600 people. We provide supported employment services, supported living services. We provide consultation to group homes, schools, families. In terms of behavior problems, we have our own preschool that we operate. We have a crisis response team. If somebody's in a behavioral crisis, we can send out a team to get it under control and create a permanent solution to the problems. We're providing services right now to about 600 or so children, adolescents, and adults in a variety of settings, mostly in Southern California. And our approach to solving problem behaviors has been empirically tested and is proven to be effective. And so we've had the opportunity to provide training to others around the world. We've provided training in dozens of countries, thousands of people. I know that sounds like an exaggeration, but it's not. And we get tremendous feedback about the effectiveness of these positive strategies. I'm going to actually spend the rest of the lecture here describing our paradigm, the model that we use in providing support to people whose problem behaviors are preventing them from having a good quality of life. I'm going to start with a discussion of the outcomes. Hopefully you can see at the far end, the bottom line here is where we're showing the dependent variables, the outcomes that we're looking for. And it's not just getting rid of problem behaviors. The circle to the far right of this picture here is called clinical and educational validity. That is technical language for improving the person's quality of life. The primary purpose of what we do is not to get rid of problems, but to give people a better quality of life. The reason we focus on the behavior is the major barrier to them having a good quality of life. So now we're going way over to the left. We want to solve that problem, we want to get rid of that barrier as quickly as possible. And by that, we mean two different things, very different things. I don't know how many of you are at all familiar with behavior analysis, but this is not a distinction that all behavior analysts are aware of or pay attention to. The one that's common is occurrence. We want to reduce the occurrence of this behavior as quickly as we can and eventually eliminate its occurrence, whether it's tantrum behavior, physical aggression, property destruction, whatever the behavior is. We want to get rid of it as quickly as possible. That's one meaning of speed and degree of effects, rapid control. But the second meaning is equally important, and in some ways, possibly, more important. And it's the severity of the behavior. When the behavior occurs, we want to react in such a way to get the quickest, safest control over that behavior. Because those behaviors put people at risk. Sometimes the person at risk is the person himself, injurious behavior, for example. Sometimes it's others, for example, staff, family, peers, community members. Sometimes it's property damage. But whatever the problem behavior is, we want to get the quickest, safest control. We want to react to it in such a way that we get the quickest, safest control over that episode, reducing what we call and measure episodic severity. And we want those solutions, those removals of occurrence and episodic severity, and the person's improvement in quality of life to be durable, to generalize across settings. In other words, we don't want to just solve that problem where we are, but wherever that person is. We want it to be accomplished through minimum negative side effects, using strategies that are acceptable to the person, to the family, to staff, to the community. It's a lot of outcomes. To accomplish that, sometimes what's needed is a comprehensive functional assessment. Behavior analysts would always want to base their plans on a functional analysis. They want to understand why the person exhibits the behavior, what the reinforcer is, what the person's getting out of it. But we've learned that sometimes it takes a comprehensive approach to assessment that helps you identify a lot of aspects and nuances that you wouldn't have been aware of just by looking at what the immediate reinforcer is for the behavior. Let me give you an example. In one case that we were involved with, the adult woman resisted getting into the car and going someplace, whether it was to the doctor's office or shopping or anything. She didn't want to be in the car. It was her aggression was quite extreme as she resisted. And if they got her in the car, she would try to get out of the car. Even when it was driving, she would try to open the door and jump out. This is a very dangerous behavior. Why is she being aggressive? She doesn't want to be in the car. That's obvious. Now, if you were a traditionalist, you might punish her aggression. You shouldn't be aggressive. Don't do that. Don't hit me. But in her case, that didn't solve the problem. The traditional treatment strategies did not solve the problem. When doing the comprehensive functional assessment, we learned something. When she was a young child, her father sexually abused her in the family car. She suffered a traumatic experience as a young child. If you wanted to solve her aggression, your plan needed to include, not just be limited to, but include treatment for her trauma. And when that was included in the plan, the problem was finally solved. There were other aspects of the plan. Again, you're gonna see what's involved in a multi-element plan, but it was that insight that helped us include what we needed to include. Another example of where assessment helped us understand the complexity of the situation, of the behavior. A adolescent girl on the spectrum, but incredibly bright, 140 IQ. So people on the spectrum can be very, very bright. Her problem is she would run away from home, being gone sometimes for days at a time, and while gone, engage in promiscuous sex with strange men, men who she had never met before, sometimes homeless men. Needless to say, this is life-threatening behavior. When we were asked to do the assessment, she was hospitalized in at the psychiatric hospital down at UCLA. But the psychiatrist needed to dismiss her because she didn't have any psychiatric problems. All she had was autism. She was on the spectrum and this problem behavior. And he asked us if we would do an assessment and come up with a case so that she would be safe when she moved out. We did the assessment and we learned a couple of things. I mean, first of all, she's living in a community that has no other people with high functioning autism. I mean, autism is not a frequent problem for people, but certainly being on the spectrum with 140 IQ makes you even a smaller minority, if you're following what I'm saying. There are no peers in this community. That's fact number one. Fact number two, her father described a very interesting incident. He had taken his daughter down to the beach and he had stayed up on the boardwalk while she was walking up and down the sand. He observes her approaching this group of men who are also on the beach and notices that they all get down on their knees as if they're praying to God. Father doesn't understand what's going on. I mean, they're not engaged in any sexual activity. They're praying. And his daughter's praying with him. He goes down, approaches them. As he approaches them, they all stand up. One of the men in the group steps forward to ask him what he wants. He explains that this girl is his daughter and he wants to know what was going on. They explain to him that they are studying in the local seminary to be priests, and his daughter asked them to have sex with her. Their reaction was not to have sex with her, but to say, "Sister, let us pray." What I found interesting about that was she didn't say, "No, let me ask somebody else. I'm looking for sex, not prayer." She engaged in prayer with them. Incident number three. Um, She, her mother, and her brother have flown back east for a family reunion. Father was not able to attend with them because he couldn't leave his job. On their return home on the airplane, the mother and brother sat on one side of the plane. The girl sat on the other side of the plane, sitting next to a strange man. In other words, somebody she didn't know. During the flight, he covered them with a blanket and sexually abused her. She did not resist. She did not act up. She did not do anything except engage in that activity with him. For the first time, what she saw, if she lets him do this, she's able to engage with him and interact with him successfully. What she's desperate for, and most of us are, is for social relationships. She doesn't know how to get them. And ultimately, the solution to her problem, the ultimate solution, was going to remain for her to become an adult and move to a community where there are peers where she could develop relationships with. Pending that, there needed to be other ways of giving her some contact with peers. And one of the things her mother did, based on the recommendation in her plan, was to take her to the Autism Society's annual conference, where other adults on the spectrum attended, some of whom were quite bright. In fact, they told mom, just leave her with us, we'll take care of her. And during the conference, the mother didn't have to be with the daughter at all. The daughter was being kept by, so to speak, her peers. She came back saying, this is the first time I've met people that are like me. This is great. And so those kinds of things were some of the ways that we were able to bridge the gap, among other things, until she was able to move to a community where she was successful. You might find it interesting to hear this. I have an update to this. This happened years ago, many years ago. My daughter Andrea ran into her recently in the community with her mother, and her mother said, this is embarrassing, but I'll say it because it's a way of follow-up. Mother said, your father saved my daughter's life. I'm telling you, this job is incredibly satisfying. So we don't know where the relevant information is going to be. That's why we got to gather all this information. Family history and background, like I said, living arrangements, health and medical issues. Let me give you one more example of where assessment helped understand the meaning of the behavior. This was a adolescent boy in a public school who engaged in physical aggression. In fact, on one occasion, he was actually physically aggressive against the principal of the school. So when I did the assessment, he was actually not allowed on the school campus. His entire school day was spent in the community with a teacher, an aide, and a paraprofessional. And this 3-to-1 ratio was costing the district a lot of money, of course. As I'm showing here, family history and background is important. And I asked to interview the parents. Of course, they were open to the interview, but I was forewarned that the father travels a lot for his work and probably would not be able to attend the interview. Well, that may be. And I was also told that they thought the problem was the mother. The mother doesn't want us to put any restriction on him, and she spoiled him. So we think the problem is the mother. Well, maybe it is. But I go out to the family home for the interview, and it's a upper middle class neighborhood. He's an only child. They live in a beautiful house. I am pleasantly surprised to find the father there. He had rearranged his schedule so he could be there. That tells me something. As is typical in many American homes, the first time you're there, they show you around. So they showed me around the house. And I noticed something, every tabletop, every shelf, everything was perfectly aligned, organized, neat. Nothing was out of place. I go to his room. Inside on his bureau is the world's largest unduplicated Pez dispenser collection. 74 unduplicated Pez dispensers, perfectly aligned. He has everything he wants. He has his own TV. Maybe he is spoiled. Maybe his mother is spoiled. Although the way the house looks, I'm thinking maybe it's not just the son who's autistic. Maybe others in the family as well. During the interview, something else is unique. The father is talking more than the mother. I've done a lot of family interviews, and in virtually every experience I've had, the mother is more talkative than the father. I'm not saying she's submissive. I'm just saying that he's doing more of the talking. And father says, there's something that I've got to share with you. He says, the other night, I was up in the upper hallway with my son. We were coming down the stairs, and he cursed at me. He said, F you, Dad. He said, I was furious. I slapped him. I said, don't you curse at me. F you, Dad. Don't you curse at me. F you, Dad. Don't you curse at me. And he said, my son cried out, Dad, I can't stop. I can't stop. He said, the father said, what I realized then is that my son had very little control over his own behavior, that we needed to take more responsibility for it. And the father wasn't aware of this, but what he was describing is something that not everybody knows about autism, and that autism is a neurologically based problem that often involves movement disturbance, neurologically based movement disturbance. If somebody's having a behavioral episode that's neurologically based and you punish it, that's similar, that's analogous to punishing somebody with a seizure disorder having a seizure. Don't you have a seizure? Don't you have a seizure? A plan to solve this boy's problem needed to take into account that he has very little control over his behavior. By the way, hearing that story, at the feedback session. The father knew I was going to be sharing it, but the father started crying himself and left the room during the feedback session. But I look around the room. There wasn't a dry eye in the house. Dry eye in the room. And they were very open to a strictly positive plan under those circumstances. So there are a lot of, I can't go through it all. I mean, but what I'm wanting you to see is that a good plan might require a full, what we call comprehensive functional assessment, where we pay attention to the process of assessment, which involves interviews, records review, observation, and interaction. The content of assessment, which I shared some of with you, and the materials. We have a behavior assessment guide, which provides the door opening questions. It can't anticipate every question you need to ask, but some of the door opening questions and the outline of what a plan should include. All that leads to the development of what we call a support plan. PBS stands for positive behavior support. Positive behavior support is applied behavior analysis in support of people with challenging behavior. And there are two sections here, what we call proactive strategies and what we call reactive strategies. Ecological strategies have to do with smoothing the fit because we find some mismatches that have to be smoothed out. I've given you some examples of that already. The person who needed trauma therapy needed trauma therapy. That was necessary. And we look at other things. One of the things that we almost always include in our recommendations is an increased time-based schedule of preferred events. In other words, not to use preferred events as reinforcers for good behavior or for the absence of bad behavior, but to use preferred events as part of the enjoyment of life. I mean, if I have dessert tonight, it's not, I hate to tell you this, it's not going to depend on whether I get good feedback from you on this lecture. Independent of whether I get good feedback on the lecture or not, I'm going to have dessert tonight. I'm going to watch what I want to watch on TV tonight. And I say that only because uncommonly, my wife is going out for dinner with some friends of hers. I'm going to be home alone. I'm going to be able to watch just the things I want to watch. Not because of anything I've done, but just because it's time. I listen to music because I like listening to music. Not because I've earned the right to listen to music. And so we have a time-based schedule of preferred events. Would be an example of an ecological strategy. A particular interactional style might be part of our ecological strategies. So we hold ourselves accountable for at least one, if not more, one recommendation of smoothing the fit and providing an ecological strategy. Those are not temporary strategies. Those are going to be lifelong strategies. Having a schedule. I can see you now. How many people have a written schedule of what they're going to do during the week? Raise your hand. Can I see that again? Raise your hand, please. Okay. I bet you a lot of the others do too, but we're not in person here, so. Now, our second category of strategies is what we call positive programming. Positive programming has to do with instruction, teaching skills. And there are four categories of skills that address in all of our plans. First are what we call functional skills. There are two categories of functional skills. One is things we need to learn how to do. We need to learn how to cook. We need to learn how to shop. We need to learn how to bathe. We need to learn how to take care of our private areas in terms of defecation and urination. We need to learn a lot of things. And so that's one category of skills that we include in our plan. Another category of skills is things we want to learn. We want to learn how to access particular websites. We want to learn how to play music, how to stream different music or different videos. We want to learn how to ski. We want to learn how to whatever. So we always want to be teaching a new fun skill and a new functional skill. That's the first category, functional skills, meaning fun and functional. Second category of skills is functionally equivalent, what we call functionally equivalent skills. Let me give you an example. Somebody who eats inedible objects. Somebody engages in what they call pica behavior or pica behavior, depending on where you're from. That's a not uncommon problem. What we want to do is teach that person where to go and what to get when they want to eat something, not just pick up something from the floor and put it in their mouth, which is what they would do. And so we might be teaching them to go to the refrigerator, open the refrigerator door, take out the low-fat yogurt or the Jell-O or the other relatively nutritious, relatively low-calorie snacks that are available there. We might teach that person how to make a smoothie, how to independently make a smoothie. So we would teach them that skill. And that would take the place of their eating an edible object. They'd be eating edible objects. There would be a related skill we had to teach. That's a third category of positive programming. And that is the related skill. We need to teach them to discriminate between edible and inedible items, because we want them to eat, when they open that refrigerator door, we want them to eat the yogurt, not the yogurt container. And so that would be another skill. That's a separate skill, discriminating edible from inedible. We did an assessment once of, this was, believe it or not, a case in Greece. I've had to do assessments around the world, and this referral was from Greece. An adult man who wouldn't leave his apartment. And the reason he wouldn't leave his apartment was because he had gotten the police interested in him because he had been harassing a female in the community. And one of the things I learned in the assessment was that one of the reasons she didn't want him to pay any attention to her, leave her alone, don't bother me, was she had at one point agreed to have coffee with him. And he was so eager to escalate this relationship that he bought her a gift at the coffee table. They just went to a, you know, coffee house. And the gift he bought her was his mother's diamond ring. And she realized this was not the man for her. At the feedback session where I'm describing what we're gonna be teaching him, I explained that, one of the things you'll wanna learn is how to advance a relationship to another stage. Of course, one of the things we wanna, prior to that, teaching the different stages in a relationship, but given he knows how the stages of a relationship would sequence, how do you move a relationship from one stage of a relationship to the next stage of the relationship? And he asked, well, how would you do that? Well, I said to him, well, suppose you wanted to bring a gift to a lady when you were out for coffee for the first time, and you could give her either a rose or a necklace, diamond necklace. Which would you do? And he said, I did that. In other words, he recognized that there was something that he needed to learn there. So positive programming. For all the recommendations that we make on the positive program, we recommend that we state in our recommendations the rationale for the recommendation, the instructional objective, and the criteria for saying, and the method that we're going to use for say, for teaching that skill. The objective would include the conditions under which the behavior will occur, the behavior we want to teach, and the criteria for saying he's learned how to do those things to criteria, to an acceptable level. That's for every recommendation in the positive program. And the fourth category of positive programming may be ultimately important for the durability of the success here. And that is teaching people how to cope with and tolerate naturally occurring aversive events. What I mean by that is no life is free of aversive events. Sometimes you have to wait for something you want. Sometimes you're not gonna get something you want. Sometimes you have to do something you don't wanna do. Life requires of all of us the performance of certain non-preferred activities, and that's a skill. How do you deal with that? And how do you teach that? Yes, one quick example of that. Young man whose aggressive behavior occurred when he was asked to wait for something. He didn't want to wait for something. The strategy there is something I call start small, move slow. You start with asking him to tolerate just the smallest amount of waiting. You want what? Oh, okay, you have to wait for it. Thanks for waiting for it, here it is. That was a split second. Next time, 3 seconds more, 4 seconds more, 8 seconds more, and so on until, believe it or not, I ran into his staff at a conference a year later. I said, how's he doing? It was February. They said, you can tell him it's February, he has to wait until June before he can go swimming. And he can wait till June before he goes swimming, even if he wants to go swimming. He learned to cope with and tolerate delay and gratification. Then you see a solid red line here. separating proactive strategies and reactive strategies. The proactive strategies are aimed towards the future. Whoops. Reducing behavior over time. The reactive strategies are aimed at getting rapid, safe control over a behavioral episode when it occurs. Situational management. When we are reacting to a problem behavior, we're not thinking about the future anymore. We're thinking about keeping everybody safe, getting the quickest, safest control over keeping people safe. And one of the reasons we don't use punishment in our proactive strategies to reduce the future occurrence of problem behavior is reactively, it increases episodic severity. Always. Instead, we'll use a variety of strategies. Redirection. Active listening. Let me describe active listening. It's very, very effective reactive strategy. Active listening is reflecting to the person, back to the person, the message they're communicating with their behavior. Making it clear that you understand what they're saying. You're not necessarily agreeing, you're not disagreeing, you're just reflecting. An example of that occurred years ago when I was consulting with a group home with delinquent adolescents. Six teenage boys, not developmentally disabled, but in a group home because of their problem behavior, pretty severe problem behavior. I'm not looking forward to this weekly visit because the staff are kind of resistant to my recommendation of strictly positive strategies with these bad boys. I think they should be punished for bad behavior. So I'm not looking forward to my visit, but I'm earning a living, so I'm needing to do it. I go up and ring the bell. I hear a weak voice inside say, come inside. I open the door, walk in, here's what I find. 5 of the 6 boys living in this home are in the living room, across the hallway, with all the staff kind of cowering there. I look down the hallway to the left from the kitchen is coming the 6th boy with a sharp knife in his hand. Very quickly, one of the staff explained that one of these boys had insulted that boy's mother and he feels he needs to do something about it. And that's why he's got the knife. He's gonna stab the boy. You already know I'm a coward. So the first thing I did was look to see if I had time to run back to my car and lock myself in the car, but I didn't. But ironically, I had just given a lecture on episodic severity on active listening the day before to a bunch of staff. And so I decided to use it. I said, you're upset about what he called your mother. Yes, you didn't like what he called your mother. Right, you felt you needed to do something about it. Correct. I'm reflecting. And I'm noticing he's not trying to get past me anymore. We are interacting and I've halted the episode. But then after a while, it got to the point where it felt redundant. Like I was repeating myself. And I remembered when I learned active listening, that when you reach that point, you want to move from active listening, from reflection to problem solving. So I said, listen, would you be willing to do something for me, please? Please do this. Say this to this boy. When I heard my mother called that name, it made me feel like Not a you statement, an I statement. There's a big difference between I statements and you statements. You may want to look that up. I statements versus you statements. So he did. He said that to this boy. And the boy said, actually apologized, said, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done that. So then I said, how are you feeling now? He says, I'm still angry. I said, try this. I picked up a pillow from the couch. I held it up. I said, punch and hit this as many times as you want. He punched it. He started laughing. He started laughing hysterically. And soon everybody in the house started laughing hysterically. Crisis was over. They were able to return to the schedule. Active listening, tremendously powerful. We might listen to this one. Redirect that person to a competing contingency. What do I mean by a competing contingency? Okay, something is upsetting the person. They're upset. And you need to do something to stop them. How about saying, hey, why don't we both sit down and have a piece of apple pie and a la mode? Apple pie and ice cream. You're introducing a competing contingency. The contingency that's motivating the behavior is still there. We're introducing a competing contingency. Isn't the apple pie going to reinforce the problem behavior? No, it's a different contingency. And all the rest of the plan would prevent reinforcement from occurring. The rest of the plan not only has its own direct effects, but also has what we call potentiating variables. Potentiates the original contingency that motivates the problem behavior. Reactive strategy, probably the mother of reactive strategies is what I call strategic capitulation. Giving into what the person wants. Person's tantruming because they don't want to get off the computer, say, okay, you don't have to get off the computer. Which is, by the way, the reactive strategy for the boy in the classroom who said, Dad, I can't stop. When he was on that computer, he was in a motor loop, neurologically based motor loop. He couldn't interfere with that. So you just say, okay, I'll come back. And so strategic capitulation. Let me give you my favorite example of that. Referral was for a person, a young adult male, who would engage in life-threatening self-injury and aggression. His self-injury would include bashing his head against hard surfaces, punching himself in the head, punching you in the face, very serious behaviors. During the interview, I asked the staff, I always ask this question, don't hardly ever get a useful answer to it, but I always ask the question, have you learned that there's anything that will stop this behavior once it's started? I expected a no. We're talking about life-threatening self-injury and aggression. And they said, yes. Really, what? They said, well, if you turn and walk away, he just stops. I said, let me see if I got this right. He's punched himself once, or he's bashed his head against the hard surface. He's pulling back his head to bash it again the second time. You turn away, he just stops. He's punched you once. He's pulling back his arm to punch you and punch you again. You turn and walk away, he just stops. At this point, I become silent. What am I supposed to say to these people? And they say, after 30 seconds of silence, the behavior specialist told us whatever we do, we shouldn't turn and walk away. Why would they say that? Because they were afraid that turning and walk away would just continue to reinforce the behavior. That's obviously what he wants. What do you think our recommendation was? When he's self-injurious or aggressive, just turn and walk away. That produced an immediate reduction in self-injury and aggression. Excuse me, immediate reduction in episodic severity, the severity of the behavior. We also use it as a precursor strategy. In other words, when engaged in, you know what his precursor behavior was? Not always, but often before an episode of aggression or self-injury, he would do this. So not only did we use turn and walk away as a reactive strategy, we use it as a focus support strategy for preventing the problem behavior when we saw precursor behavior, along with other focus support strategies, including schedules of reinforcement. Okay, I've been on for an hour, so I don't have time to talk about mediation, but staff training, the model calls for training natural mediators, staff, and professionals talk about training that is general, that is everything they need to know, not just specific to the plan, skills specific to the plan, and complying to those general and specific skills. I'm afraid we don't have time for all that now. But behavior has meaning. You want to understand why the person is doing what they're doing from their point of view. Dad, I can't stop. All I want is a social relationship. I just need to be alone right now. Nobody's paying attention to the fact that I was abused as a child. Listen to what the behavior has. Behavior has meaning. We help people move out of Camarillo State Hospital. A few years ago, one of those people left the state hospital as a 60-year-old. We emphasize employment for the adults that we support. And we said, but you're 60 years old. You don't need to work. He said, I'm a man, I want to work. So we found him a job. My daughter Andrea manages our supported employment service here in Camarillo. She says, Jimmy wants you to come up and see him manage his job. So I went up and took pictures of Jimmy. I want you to show you what I saw. And these pictures are with Jimmy's, and use of his name is with his permission.
If you change your mind, take a chance on the first in line. Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around. If you got no place to go, bring me down. If you're all alone, then it's pretty. That's all for me, I'm still free. Take a chance on me.
You saw him doing a job he wanted. He wanted to work in a cafeteria. He got a job at the Ventura College, Community College. You can see he loved his job. He kept his own data. He kept his own timesheet. You saw his job coach there briefly. She loved her job as much as he loved his job. If you want to know why I do what I do, you're seeing why I do what I do. We're always hiring people. So here's the local Camarillo managers for our services, if you want. If you're interested in part-time or full-time job, give them a call. I don't know how useful this has been to you or informative it's been to you. I think there are implications here. If we can solve problem behaviors using strictly positive strategies, maybe we should consider expanding this technology. What would our relationships be like if we raise a generation of children without punishment? I'm not talking about letting kids do what they want to do. I'm talking about discipline. Discipline's, you know what the word discipline is rooted in? The word that stands for teaching, not punishment. A disciple wasn't a punisher of Christ. He was a teacher of Christ. We're talking about teaching, not punishing. We're talking about discipline, using strictly positive strategies. What would our world be like if we raised a generation of children without punishment? If our relationships with each other, our employees, our employers, were based on positive practices instead of the negative practices that characterize too many relationships? I think the implications are amazing. Thank you very much. I'm willing to take any questions you want to ask.
Anybody have a question for him? I have a couple. Nobody? Hey, Gary, we've talked about, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. We've talked about lots of different treatment modalities, and you talked about behavioral. Do you use any other modalities, or is it strictly behavioral?
Well, the functional analysis may identify problems that the person has that requires other modalities. And that would be recommended under the heading of ecological strategies. If the person needs, for example, psychiatric treatment, we would refer them to a psychiatrist. And that would be, and I consider that part of the plan. That's part of the ecology. That's part, if they're not getting the I talked about trauma therapy, that would be necessary. And so, yes, there are other practices that the person may need, as you would uncover, or should uncover, through a comprehensive functional assessment. And then if you don't have the skills or the credentials yourself to provide that service, your plan needs to include getting that somewhere else.
And what diagnoses do you guys treat? Is it predominantly autism?
We don't treat diagnoses, we treat behaviors. Regardless of what the person's diagnosis is. A lot of the referrals we get are for people on the spectrum, but we work with people who are not developmentally disabled and train people to work with other populations as well.
Any questions about Camera State?
Say that again?
I was just asking them if they had any questions about Camera State Hospital. Some of them didn't know this was the campus. Forever ago. You're one of the first psychologists there. My unit was the last to go. So I was one of the last. Anybody have any questions about that? No? All right. Yeah, so I failed to tell them that you're also an excellent cook and you grow epic luau's. I went to school with, she's one of my dear friends from high school, so I think I've been going to your house for over 35 years. So thank you for putting that up. They were asking for that.
Yeah.
So a lot of my previous students and interns have worked for IBA. It's an excellent source for you guys' applications for graduate school. And just your gen, it, you know, gives you some experience if you want to pursue your career in technology. So thank you, Gary, so much, or Dr. LaVigna, for sharing your career path and your specialties. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure. And if you can send me a copy of the video, Tracy, I'd appreciate it.
You bet I will.
Okay.
Oh, we have one more question.
Okay.
Okay.
He mentioned that he was kind of embarrassed based on the follow up of the girl of the mother who said that that he saved his daughter's life. I was interested to understand, why did you feel embarrassed? Because for one, I'm fairly grateful for the contributions you've done.
I just didn't want to. I didn't want to be seen bragging about anything. You know, I mean.
On the contrary, it's inspirational.
Inspirational, he's saying.
Thank you very much. if we had time, I could share more similar kinds of feedback that I've gotten. That and it always blows me away. But it's like what I do. I don't know if you figured it out, but I'm 80 years old, and I'm still doing this because I like it. And it's meaningful to me, and I'm hoping some of you people follow along.
All right, thanks for being an inspiration to all of us.
Okay, thank you very much, everybody.
All right, take care, thank you.
Okay.